Good morning, class. I'm your teacher, Lori Maitland, and welcome to my YouTube channel, Tribute to 10cc. Today in music class, we're going to talk about their third album from 1975, released on the Mercury record label called The Original Soundtrack. The only song I like is I'm Not in Love, the serious version of that song, without Kathy Redfern bragging and boasting. So let's play this serious version right now without Kathy Redfern interrupting the song as a concept music video with relevant clips of Steve and Kayla taken from a soap opera, Days of Our Lives, arguing with each other and breaking up ever since their first marriage falls out of favor, which it teaches you the importance of why two people as a boyfriend and a girlfriend or a husband and a wife aren't in love with each other, since there is no meaning of love in life when love and togetherness had to end this way. And why they are separated from each other, which it breaks up the family. That matches the words Eric Stewart sang years ago.
It's just a silly phase I'm going through. And just because I call you up, don't get me wrong, don't think you got it made. I'm not in love, no, no.
It's
If you like the serious version of the song I'm Not in Love done by 10cc that I always enjoy listening to without Kathy Redfern butting in, raise your hand. If you hate the original epic version of the song with Kathy Redfern cutting Eric Stewart off, thumbs down. So, the serious version is the winner.
Yes, there it is.
I don't like the original epic version with Kathy Redfern butting in, trying to cut Eric Stewart off, because I am not happy about their version, which is a little too long for me. And besides, you know, I am not very happy about that. So I would stick to the serious version of that song without Kathy Redfern cutting him off. You know the line during the bridge section, "You'll wait a long time for me." It means you're going to miss me for a long time when you tell me goodbye. And my fact is about that song, I never find it funny. I find it very serious. I never find that song too confusing. I find that song very heartfelt and very touching. That's my honest fact. I keep wondering why there is no serious version of that song, I'm Not in Love, without Kathy Redfern criticizing the way Eric Stewart was singing. Maybe that's because the pop radio stations had no time to omit her negative interjection in mid-song, which I know is a big issue happening to me. Neither did 10cc's record label owned by Polygram Records, Mercury. And the worst thing of all is it ruined in midsection, and I'm not happy about the way Kathy made a big deal out of Eric Stewart after Lol Cream's solo piano playing. I made my first comment on YouTube about the song, and it said, "Too bad that the song on a 7-inch 45 RPM single had Kathy Redfern's annoying Be Quiet, Big Boys Don't Cry junk ruining in mid-song that 10cc's record label Mercury had no time to omit. Plus, it's too bad that the repeated first verse was omitted too abruptly. I will call that song very heartfelt and bittersweet, that touches my heart, because it's mainly all about marriage, relationship, falling out of favor. Besides, it's very touching." Another comment I made on YouTube and said, "It's too bad that a 1975 British band, 10cc, might have taken a break from having a wacky sense of humor and started concentrating on a serious, relevant version of the bittersweet, heartbreaking ballad, I'm Not in Love, minus Kathy Redfern's self-parody, and believe me, it is 10 times better than the epic 6-minute version of that song with her negative part in the middle added." I feel sorry for Miss Kathy Redfern, because in midsection, she made a big deal out of Eric Stewart by insulting him to be quiet in a disruptive manner, which I am not happy about, and started opinionating that big boys don't cry, which I know is false. So the only thing is, I am not satisfied about the way she was cutting him off in mid-song, and I don't like it.
Oh, no.
The question is, how could she do this to him? I repeat, how could Kathy do this to Eric? That's not nice, and you know it's wrong. Don't you ever realize that it makes no kind of sense?
No.
When she did that mid-song, it made the song go off. And furthermore, it's out of the question. So the best thing I could do was remove her negative part that occurred in mid-song that I am not thrilled with and make it shorter than the epic version shown in the LP. The rest of the songs are not my favorites, so let's do the album review together as one. Side one kicks off with One Night in Paris, which is the worst. So here are the credits for that song. On vocals, pianos, vibes, and percussion, Lawrence Neal Cream. On vocals and steel guitar, Eric Stewart. On vocals, bass, and percussion, Graham Gouldman. And on vocals, drums, timpani, and percussion, Kevin Godley. Others included Madame Bezier, Tourist, Off Stage Chorus, Coquette and the Girls, Voice of the Streets, Five Hustlers, Everyone, Chinese Tarts, Voices of the Streets, Club Clientele, Henry's Lover, and the whole cast. Next track is I'm Not in Love, my favorite serious ballad about heartbreak, separation, depression, and lament. That is always a successful number one hit of 1975. This is where Eric Stewart croons so softly in a buttery, smooth, creamy, and soulful manner. And that's what satisfies my soul, just because I like soft and light music. That's why I believe this song, I'm Not in Love, is more meaningful to me than Kathy Redfern's negative, scolding midsection that has no message at all. For the serious version of I'm Not in Love, that I am really fond of, here are the song credits. On lead vocal and Fender Rhodes electric piano, Eric Stewart. On synclavier and strange musical effects, James Newton Howard, John Appleton, and Suzanne Chiani, though left uncredited. On guitar, bass, and backup vocals, Mr. Graham Gouldman. On Moog, synthesizer, bass, drum, and backup vocals, Mr. Kevin Godley. And on piano and backup vocals, Lawrence Neal Cream. For the original epic clever version that I won't be proud of, same people on same instruments and vocals. On the scolding, disruptive, insulting, whispering voice, Kathy Warren Redfern, who made a big deal out of Eric Stewart in midsection that messed up the song so meaningful. The third track I'm not happy about is Blackmail because of its too much heavy breathing and too much whispering that I am not fascinated with. And also, on that song, I am not happy about the loud, violent screaming over the feedback solo that I am not fond of. Plus, speaking of that song, Blackmail, that side one closes out with, I don't like hard and heavy music because you know why? It doesn't satisfy my brain. So I prefer the soft and light music, which is only the best for me. Anyway, here are the song credits. On vocals and organ, Lawrence Neal Cream. On vocals and drums, Kevin Godley. On vocal, guitar, steel, guitar, and piano, Eric Stewart. And last but not least, on vocal, guitar, and bass, Graham Goldman. Side 2 opens up with the second sitting for the Last Supper that I am not pleased with, which it ate up, a decent single by Polly Cutter. I'm satisfied. Since I wouldn't be proud of that song called The Second Sitting for the Last Supper, I cannot stand that bad N-word that upsets families and children. And that's what makes me feel like I want to break down in tears. Also, it's too heavy metal for me, so I intended to change it to new, clean, decent songs such as Channel Swimmer and Good News, now shown on both Bandcamp and on the bootleg CD. Anyway, here are the song credits for that song, The Second Sitting for the Last Supper. On lead vocal, guitar, organ, piano, electric piano, and backup vocals, Eric Stewart. On drums, percussion, and backup vocals, Kevin Godley. On guitar, percussion, piano, and backup vocals, Lawrence Neal Cream. And on guitar, bass, and backup vocals, Graham Goldman. Second song is Brand New Day. And here are the song credits for that song. On lead vocal, marimba, bass, drums, timpani, cellos, and backup vocals, Kevin Godley. On second lead vocal, guitar, and backup vocals, Mr. Eric Stewart. On pianos, gizmo, violins, Moog, and backup vocals, Lawrence Neal Cream. And on bass, double bass, and backup vocals, Graham Goldman. Third one is Flying Junk, so here are the song credits. On lead vocal, lead guitar, electric piano, and acoustic piano, Eric Stewart. On bass, acoustic guitar, six-string bass auto harp, and backup vocals, Graham Goldman. On acoustic guitar, piano, auto harp, and backup vocals, Lawrence Neal Cream. On drums, percussion, and backup vocals, Mr. Kevin Godley. Fourth one is a little too goofy for me, called Life is a Minestrone, so here are the song credits. On lead vocal, piano, electric piano, percussion, guitar, and backup vocals, Lawrence Neal Cream. On drums, timbali, percussion, and backup vocals, Kevin Godley. On guitar and backup vocals, Eric Stewart. And last but not least, on bass, guitar, acoustic guitar, and backup vocal, Graham Goldman. And side two finishes off with The Film of My Love, which I'm not familiar with. Remember when I was just hearing the song called The Film of My Love on YouTube? I thought it was Kevin Godley singing the lead, but no, to my surprise, when I looked at the song credits, it was Graham Gouldman singing the lead instead of Kevin. Anyway, here are the song credits for the song. On lead vocal, bass, guitar, and mandolins, Graham Gouldman. On guitar, organs, percussion, and backup vocals, Eric Stewart. On piano, percussion, mandolins, and backup vocals, Lawrence Neil Krem. And last but not least, on bongos, percussion, and backup vocals, Mr. Kevin Godley. Since I am not crazy about tongue-in-cheek business, I like the songs that have more meaning. Before Ross Goodall takes a turn of reviewing this album from 1975, let's play Dennis Englewood's man-made 1972 sound-alike sweet soul ballad version of the 10cc song I'm Not in Love, mainly all about heartbreak, separation, depression due to family issues, breakup, lament, and sadness. Now shown on both Bandcamp and CD Baby. So here are the song credits for his sweet soul ballad version of the 10cc song. For Dennis's soul ballad version of the 10cc song, on lead vocal, Dennis Englewood, accompanied by the Tom Bell Orchestra, and last but not least, on backing vocals, Dennis Englewood himself, Joyce Berry, Sue Fleming, and me. So here is the tribute video of that song dedicated to Valerie Simpson, who was in love with Nicholas Ashford until the day he died of throat cancer.
Just a silly phase I'm going through, and just because I call you up, don't get me wrong, don't think you've got it made. Not again, it doesn't mean you
Before the class is dismissed, here are some multiple choices. Which is more man-made? Dennis Englewood's soul ballad version of I'm Not in Love, or the original one done by 10cc with too many overpowering, strange, synclavier, choral voices messing up the real thing? If you choose Dennis Englewood's soul ballad version that is more man-made, then you're absolutely correct. Now, which version is part man-made and part man-machine? Either 10cc's original I'm Not in Love or Dennis Englewood's 1972 sound-alike Sweet Soul Ballad remake from 1987. If you choose 10cc's original that is part man-made with electric piano, rhythm guitar, piano and bass, and part man-machine with Moog synth bass drum and overpowered synclavier choral voices messing up the real thing, which they sound like dinosaurs roaming the earth, then you're definitely correct. Now, which is better for you to pay attention to? Either the meaningful song I'm Not in Love, sung by Eric Stewart from 10cc, that has a positive, heartfelt message which it can teach the youth, families, and children, you and me, and every human race from all over the world, both far and wide, which it tells the tale of love and darkness, or the annoying Be Quiet, Big Boys Don't Cry junk ruining in mid-song done by Kathy Warren Redfern that contains no message at all. If you choose the meaningful song as a serious version without Kathy Redfern's part, I'm Not in Love, then you're absolutely correct. Now it's Ross Goodall's turn to do an album review of this album.
Hello everyone and welcome to this video. Now this is going to be an album review today where I'm going to be looking at this this album release from 10cc. It is the original soundtrack. So in this video I will just do my usual thing, show you the vinyl copy of the album, what I've got, and also go over the album's tracks as well. So this was the band's third studio album, released in March 1975. Around this time they had signed a new record deal with the label Mercury Records. Before this, the first two albums were on the label UK Records, who were a small independent label, but the band felt that they weren't getting like enough money, like they had a bad deal with like this company, whereas like this other company, Mercury Records, decided to sign them after hearing the song I'm Not In Love. They were like convinced it was a masterpiece, and decided to sign the band, the album was released a couple of weeks later. So that's all like the recording and like production already been done before they signed this new record contract. It was commercially successful as well, reached number 4 in the UK, only got to 15 like in like America. They didn't really break America, 10cc, really. I mean, but certainly like the song on here, like the big hit on here, I'm Not In Love, is a huge worldwide hit and like is a signature song. So I'll just show you the vinyl here. The album cover, I've got mixed feelings about the album itself. It was designed by the design group Hypnostics, who also responsible for a lot of 10cc's other albums and also like a lot of Pink Floyd's artwork as well. This is a nice drawing here done by the artist Humphrey Ocean here of an old sort of film and like a film projector, I think it is. And then it sort of continued on like the gatefold there with a sort of picture of the band. Track listing information, and then we have the album in here. So we have a lyric insert with it, just lyrics, move that over there. And then the album itself here, as you can see, is on the new label, Mercury Records here. So I now just go over all of the album's tracks. So the album opens up with the song Une Nuit à Paris, One Night in Paris, that translates as. This is quite a strange song, to be fair. It is a Godley and Creme composition. Kind of shows the way what like the words go like the direction like they were going on like their album Consequences, what was released 1977, shortly after they decided to leave 10cc. It's also notable this was the second to last album Godley and Creme were on, like as like 10cc, and the only other one was that was How Dare You, was like the last one what they were on. But they are on this one here, and like they do play like a big role like in like the making of this album. Especially this song here, it is sort of like a mini opera, kind of about like a guy's experience and staying in Paris. Supposedly as well, this song was a big influence on Queen with their song Bohemian Rhapsody, like especially like all like the opera vocals bits and like the middle of that song. Certainly you can hear like the influence like from this song and and Queen have like said themselves that like this song certainly influenced them. For me though, this song is maybe a bit veering towards the sort of experimental side, and I personally have to be like in like the mood to like really like enjoy it and like appreciate it. Like it's not one where I can just stick on and like whatever mood I'm in. I have to really I want to hear this song to really enjoy it. But there are some bits of this that are really nice. There's a bit like middle where it's like there's sort of like a piano thing going, but it's going like quite fast, like the drum sort of gets faster and like builds up like momentum in like the middle of the track. I love that bit, but just like the rest of the song, I mean like it's pretty strange, pretty weird, but that was 10cc for you really. And then we go on with second track, which is the absolute classic I'm Not In Love. Certainly this is their signature song, it was a huge hit for them, number one in Britain. I believe it got to number two in number two in America, and was one of their only hits over there. Certainly it has it's a song that has endured very, very well, and was recently featured I believe it was the opening scene to the film Guardians of the Galaxy. So it's still a very, very popular song. For me personally, I love it, but I've maybe overheard it just a tad, because you hear it all the time, and for me, wouldn't rank it among my absolute favourite 10cc songs, simply because I've overheard it, but I won't take anything away from it. It is a bloody brilliant song. But again, you have to appreciate as well, the way they recorded this track as well, with the vocal layers going on. There's a documentary thing, well, it's not really a documentary, but there's a video on YouTube, which some guy has put together, just a fan of interview footage from the other members, talking about how they actually constructed this track. It's quite interesting. They actually just recorded different notes and then double tracked them, triple tracked them, and then when they were mixing it, they just would put up the different faders and they get the chords, so they could actually just play along to the song with these vocal tracks. It sounds absolutely great, and it is a classic song. So side one then closes with a track called Blackmail, and this is very interesting, kind of disco infused song, kind of before disco became a big thing, really. The actual song itself isn't my favourite 10cc song, and it certainly is is that one of the points I'm going to make in this video about about them, their albums can be a bit inconsistent. I mean, and with 10cc, it tends to be the hits and the bigger songs are most usually the better ones of the albums, and the albums have some good tracks, but also a lot of slightly lesser, I wouldn't say filler material, but slightly lesser songs that wouldn't really be considered as material for a single. And this song is probably one of them. It's just maybe a bit too strange, weird for me to really like, but it does have a fantastic guitar solo at the end of it. We'll have to definitely mention that. Side 2 then opens with a song called Second Sitting for the Last Supper, and I really like this song actually. This is probably what I would call a hidden gem from them almost. It was actually performed live. I believe it opens their live album, Live and Let Live. I believe this is the first song on that. It's just a great song. I love the introduction to it, and then you get the heavy and the really heavy guitar riffs going on. Sounds absolutely fantastic, and then the different sections it goes through. It has to be one of my absolute favourites from this album. It's just a great song. When you open your eyes to next one on side 2 is a song called Brand New Day. This is another Godly and Creme number, kind of eerie piano star, but it's a slower ballad that it develops into. I do kind of like this one though. I mean, that's not a song that I would especially seek out to play, but it's not one what I don't like. It's kind of just in the middle for me, but it is still a good song. Next one up is a song called Flying Junk, and this is probably the weakest one on the album for me, or one of the weakest ones. Kind of just filler material on it for me. This is the point I'm making about their albums tended to be filled with great singles I'm Not In Love and Life Is A Minestrone on this album here, and then a lot of other slightly lesser songs that aren't as good as like the single material. And like that, I'm like this is like certainly like one of them. It's that's okay, has some nice guitar work, but it's like a forgettable song really. Like I mean, like I'm struggling now to remember like what it goes like, because I'm just like reading like up notes here, like what I made like when I was listening to it, but now I'm just trying to think of it, and like I've just it's completely like gone out of my head. Second to last track then is a song called Life is a Minestrone. Very quirky and very interesting song. A bit sort of like nonsensical, like the lyrics on this one here. But a fun track. It was a single. This one hit number 7 in like the UK charts, which was great. And certainly like I could see Wings doing this song here, because McCartney's lyrics in like the 70s as well were also maybe not like the most advanced lyrics. They were certainly fun and like everything, but they weren't. They didn't have like, that much depth to them, so like this is one where like I could certainly see this as like a wing sort of track, yeah, I just like love it a lot. Like it maybe drags on a little bit, they maybe repeat like the chorus like a couple too many times, but it's still just like a great song, I feel. And then the album closes with probably this is the weakest one like on the album. Song called The Film of My Love. Another strangest song, believe this is another called the Increme number, and it isn't too great, I feel. Kinda gets annoying like after a while, and like they were kinda becoming a little bit almost pretentious a little bit, like on like this song here, like on like back on certain points like on this album, so like on like back on like the first two sheet music and back on like the debut, that this sort of kind of song was like that was done in like a fun sort of like light-hearted way, but this one here, it just seems like it's trying to be a bit too serious for like what it like actually is, and like I'm trying to be a bit too much like anti-commercial, I feel. So then we also get a couple of non-album B-sides as well. They're not on this vinyl edition, but they are on a remastered CD, what I believe you can get. The songs are Channel Swimmer, which is actually a pretty good song. Could have actually been on like the second side of that, this album, like maybe instead of The Film of My Love or Flying Junk, would have maybe like improved the album. And then we also have, and then another track is Good News. Well, I believe this was the B-side to I'm Not In Love. And this isn't very interesting song, very much just B-side material, really. So I hope you have enjoyed me going over this album here. For me, this is kind of like inconsistent album, really. I'm just gonna like say again, it really is a single sort of like the main attraction like on here. Like I'm Not In Love, great song. Life is a Minestrone, and also the second sitting for The Last Supper as well is great too. And then there are like a couple of like other songs on here, that aren't that great, to be honest. Still, they're still alright, but they're just like they're not songs that I want to really hear like over like again and again and again. Right, so what to give this out of 10? And I'd probably say about a 7 out of 10 for this here, because I mean like you have got a couple, you've got about 3 or 4 really really good top tier tracks, and then like a couple of like other ones that like are a bit on the strange sort of weird side as well. So yeah, it is a mixed album, but 7 out of 10 I do think is fair, because it does have some classics on it as well. So if you have enjoyed this review, please leave in the comments if you have like any requests for future reviews. Also, please like the video if you want, and subscribe to my channel, and I will see you next time. Goodbye.
Right Here and Now, off from their third album, the original soundtrack, we're going to play only 2 songs, such as Life is a Minestrone, sung by Lal Cream on lead vocals, and the montage breakup version of I'm Not In Love, sung by Mr. Eric Stewart on lead vocals, with clips of Steve and Kayla arguing with each other at bedtime, from a soap opera Days of Our Lives, then Chester and his wife arguing with each other after Tina trying to get good grades at school, stating that they're not in love due to family issues, taken from the 1981 American Hallmark Hall of Fame television film about the life of Chicago-based African-American teacher Marva Collins, the Marva Collins story. Thank you so much for subscribing my YouTube channel, Tribute to 10cc, and I hope to see you again sometime. Bye-bye.
Skellerin and Hold On to Love at Sound 21. Going down two spots at 23, we go for the 10cc. Let's go for a little minestrone. I'm feeling a bit hungry. How about you? Try it, because life is just one big minestrone.
Dancing on the White House lawn. She gets more fan mail than the Pope. She takes the Mickey out of all my phobias, like signing checks to ward off double pneumonia. Life is a minestrone, served up with promise and cheese. Death is a cold lasagna, suspended in big freeze.
Why did you make me do that?
Do what, sweetie?
You know exactly what. We should have told Rowan about those tattoos and Orpheus' safe.
No, I'm not telling anybody anything.
I don't like holding things from my brother.
Roman is with the ISA, Kayla.
So why don't we tell him and not the ISA?
Shh. Do you know where Orpheus is right now?
No.
No, you don't. He's one step ahead of us. He's getting information, and I don't know how.
Well, not from Roman.
Maybe not. But the point is, everywhere we want to be, he gets there before us, and I don't want to see that happen again.
I still don't see I can think there's Roman.
I don't think anything. Four people have been blown away, Kayla. And if you don't mind, I don't want to be the next.
I never lied to my brother before.
Come on, Kayla, you didn't lie. You just withheld the truth.
Oh, don't give me that. That's exactly what I did. I lied. I told him that you weren't holding out on him.
You told a little white lie.
Damn it, Steve. Roman should know about this.
I'll tell you what I'll do. This is the best I'll do. I'm going to think about it tonight. I'll give you my decision in the morning.
Education. Tina in the fifth grade, that woman teaching her the ABC.
Shh, hear you.
I don't care if she hear me. Look at it. It is not right.
Miss Collins explained that when I picked Tina up. She says Tina's been too wounded to be corrected much. She has to take it slow, win Tina's confidence.
Just like that other school. Hold her hand. Have her make mistakes till she fail altogether. I won't have it, Leela. I won't.
It's been one day, Chester. Give the woman a chance.
I want you to get your money back. Take that girl and put her in a parochial school, and I want you to do it tomorrow.
That's what you want, then you do it. But don't go taking back none of my money. That smile on my baby's face is the first one I've seen in months. And at $200, I think that's a real bargain.
I keep your picture upon the wall. It hides a nasty stain. There's lying there. So don't you ask me to give it back. I know you know it doesn't mean that much to me.